to sing together in number 700 and a couple of more other songs, which will be given to us by our song leader this morning. And that is Brother Delight. We're going to have verses 1, 3, and 4, and more songs.
Six nine six. Lord, I hear of showers of blessings. Yeah. Thou art scattering full and free.
Yeah.
Showers the thirsty land refreshing. Let some drops now fall on me.
Yeah.
May those drops fall on you this morning. We're going to take the first verse, the fourth verse, and the fifth verse while seated. The first, the fourth, and the fifth. One ninety-seven in the same hymn book. There shall be showers of blessings.
Amen.
They will be showers of blessings.
Amen.
This morning. Oh, may they fall upon us today.
Amen.
We're going to take the first verse again, and the third and the fourth while seated. The first, the third, and the fourth. Just the chord, please. wonderful singing. 198, we'll take the first and the second verse. God is here and that to bless us. Song before prayer will be 194. Come, thou fount of every blessing. Tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing. Call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious measure, sung by flaming tongues above. All the vast, the boundless treasure of my Lord's unchanging love. May God bless us this morning. We'll sing the first verse while seated, and we'll stand up to sing, for those of us that can, the third verse, and remain standing to be led in prayer.
Remain standing with our eyes closed. We call on Brother Felix to lead us in congregational prayer.
Father God, we thank you this morning.
Amen.
You are God of grace, God of mercy, quick to fulfill your word. You are God of the early rain, you are God of the latter rain.
Yes.
You change not, you are the same yesterday, today, and forever. Those things you promised, Father, and brought to pass in the past, you are God, quick to do them this era, in our day, today. God, as we come before you, Father, you know each and every one of us hearts and desire. But, oh Lord, we pray that, God, for those that come before you seeking salvation, save this morning, Father. Sanctify this morning, Father. And pour out your Holy Spirit from above and fill it in every heart, oh Father. Oh God, we thank you. We commit this service in your hands, Father. As the word will come, we pray that you anoint it.
Amen.
And you anoint our hearts, Father, that we may learn.
Amen.
That we may be corrected.
Amen.
Oh God, as we are on this journey, we thank you for Jesus Christ, whom you gave, God, for our Pentecost. We thank you this day. We thank you this morning, Father. As we come before you, Father, answer each and every prayer.
Amen.
Heal, Father, those that are sick.
Amen.
Mend the broken hearts.
Amen.
Father, we come before you and we commend the rest of this service into your hands in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
The fact that all the revival situations and incidents in the past that we've been studying and looking at, whether you've ever given thought to the fact that it was in a meeting like this, where people gathered together and their hearts were tuned to heaven. And God saw that in heaven, and he rained down power from above upon them. The one that we've heard about Azusa Street, it wasn't anything to do with the building. It has to do with the heart of the people.
Yes.
The one that we all know in this very country, at Lahore in Wales, with Evan Roberts. It was in a meeting also like this, where they gathered together and they were hungry and thirsty. And God saw that from heaven. It has got nothing to do with any fleshly manifestations, but the condition of the heart.
Yes.
And as we look up to heaven this morning, and actually throughout the month, as we have been doing, we can as well still expect God to visit us both as a church as well as individuals.
Amen.
There is what is called the revival of the soul.
Yes.
And of course, there is a combined one as well. And we're expecting the Lord to visit us in a special way.
Amen.
And the Lord will do that.
Amen.
That's not going to happen as a result of doing anything on our part in terms of jumping up and down. It has to do with the condition of our heart. And we all want to set the condition of our heart right. So we're going to listen to a solo. At the end of that solo, the choir will go down to the seats that have been prepared before them and for them. And then we have all our churches all around the jurisdiction under our supervision, as we have arranged. They will join us, and then we will briefly review our lessons on revival that we just finished before the Easter, at the end of which everyone will have the opportunity to seek the face of God. Amen. God bless you.
Let's go!
sing together from hymn number CGS 442. For our other branches joining exactly at this point, you're welcome to merge together with the Peckham branch, as we have already arranged, and we want to blend our voices with yours wherever you are, within the UK and outside the UK. We want to sing together, "Revive thy work, O Lord.
Amen.
Disturb this sleep of death.
Amen.
Create soul thirst for thee. Revive thy work, O Lord."
Amen.
Let's say verses 1, 2, and 5. Verses 1, 2, and 5. "Revive thy work, O Lord." Let's read from the Bible, the book of Psalms 85, Psalm 85. I like to read from verse 4 through to 7. Psalm 85, I'm reading from verse 4. "Turn us, O God, of our salvation, and cause thine anger toward us to cease. Will thou be angry with us forever? Will thou draw out thine anger to all generations? Will thou not revive us again, that thy people may rejoice in thee? Show us thy mercy, O Lord, and grant us thy salvation."
Amen.
Amen. You know, the month of April is a special month.
Yes.
It's a wonderful month in all respects. The name of this month is of, I read that it's of Assyrian Babylonian origin. And in the Torah, it is called the month of Aviv. It is a spring month of 30 days. Can be thinking of what month that is. The Assyrians of today refer to this month as the month of happiness.
Amen.
And in the name of Jesus,
Amen,
may this month,
Amen,
of Abib be a month of happiness.
Amen.
For you and for me.
Amen.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
On the Gregorian calendar, it is called Nisan, which answered nearly to our April, where we are now. For the Hebrews, we all know to some extent that for the Hebrews, the first month of their ecclesiastical year is this month of April, the year called Abib, which signifies the time when the ears of grain and freshness came upon the land. And of course, from the Bible, it was referred to as a special month, the month of deliverance.
Amen.
When God changed their calendar and said, this is going to be your first month, the month of their deliverance from the Egyptian bondage. And no wonder it's a month of freshness. No wonder it's a month of happiness. May God make you happy.
Amen.
May God make me happy.
Amen.
The Lord is able to do that. It was the month that God chose to pour out his spirit, as we have studied this morning. Still the same month. God chose that month to pour out his spirit upon some people that gathered together waiting for the fulfillment of the promise of God, for the downpour of the Spirit of God. They prayed, they separated themselves, went into fasting and calling upon God, and God chose on the 9th of that month of 1906 in April, the fire fell. And the founder of the Apostolic Faith Church, the name Sister Florence Crawford, was present in that meeting.
Amen.
I'm glad that our church has a root.
Amen.
A root that is deep rooted in revival.
Amen.
You know, there are many things that make people to start churches today. I have nothing against that. God has not told me to go and start one. But I've heard many people talking about, God asked me, I saw a vision. God says, you go and start a church, and God bless them. It's between them and God.
Yeah.
And God is able to bless that.
Amen.
And some people have heard too, maybe as a result of quarrel, there's a split, and then they go and start another church. I pray that the Lord will bless them too.
Amen.
But for my church,
amen,
for our church,
amen,
it has a root.
Amen.
And it is important that we understand that root.
Amen.
Rooted in revival.
Amen.
The founder of our church was present, and Apostolic Faith Church was born. Praise God.
Amen.
You will note in our lesson of this week, this one that we studied this morning, for those of you that are still using the booklet, you will see there that in parentheses, it is put anniversary lesson. Did you notice that?
Yeah.
The former and the latter rain. Then in parentheses, anniversary lesson. And the reason being that it's a special time, anniversary of the beginning of our church. This year, April, we can say that by the special grace of God, we are celebrating 111 years.
Amen.
That's the anniversary that we are enjoying, and we praise God for that.
Amen.
The Lord has made this gospel to spread all over the world. And guess what? In 1976, Apostolic Faith London was born.
Amen.
It was born, and guess what? When? The pioneer, Reverend Victor Okusoya, that God used, you can still speak to him today. He's still in our midst.
Amen.
What month did that happen? He told us. We were made to understand it happened in April.
Amen.
We thank God for the month of April.
Amen.
For us, it has a significance. I won't take all those things to be coincidence.
No.
I believe the Lord is working on something,
amen,
and we don't want to joke with that. So, for example, if you want to do any celebration, well, we are 41 years old.
Amen.
Praise God.
Amen.
And the church is marching on.
Amen.
Glory and honor be unto God,
amen,
for that.
Thank you.
Remember what I said, it's a month of happiness. It's a month of happiness for what the Lord has done and for what he is still able to do. The work continued to prosper and then started to spread around the UK and beyond. And for those of you listening to me, even in this assembly, as well as on the webcast, wherever you are, more especially within Western Europe, you are recipients of that work that God started through our pioneer here. We thank God for that.
Amen.
It is important for us to have some history.
Yes.
You know what? I used to be, pardon me, I cannot separate myself from what used to be my profession whenever I need to gain from that. As a lecturer, we teach something called History of Management Thought. It's a year one or level 100, as they call it now, a module. And one important question we ask the students will be, what are the values of studying history of management? Why do we need to know the history? History is very important. History helps us to know where we are coming from. History helps us to know where we are. History helps us to know where we are going. Where there is no historical foundation upon which to build, one may just be doing things here and there. History of our church will help us to know why we do things the way we do things. Because we have a root.
Yes.
Because we have a foundation.
Yes.
And that foundation is Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And we don't want to lay any other foundation.
No.
The one that has been laid is solid enough.
Amen.
I just pray that God will help you.
Amen.
God will help me.
Amen.
To build on that foundation.
Amen.
We are recipients of that. You know, more personal for me, in the year 2000, when we needed to have a pastor change after about 24 years of service of the pioneer of this work, and I was given the privilege to serve by taking the leadership battle of the work to continue. Guess, when did that happen? It was in April. That is personal to me. That's why April for me, apart from all I've said, even for me personal. And that was not planned with anybody. That wasn't a plan in terms of things have been happening in April. Let's do this in April. Let's do that in April. God planned it.
Yes.
And everything fitted well together.
Amen.
Next Sunday, perhaps about this time, 17 years ago, by next Sunday, I will be celebrating my own 17th year anniversary.
Amen.
And I'm happy that I'm going to be with the young people.
Amen. Amen.
I won't be here. Should Jesus tarry, or perhaps be with the Lord. But the plan is to be with the young people. And I'm going to have a good time with them. I'm not taking over your youth camp, but I will be around to celebrate with you.
Amen.
So that you can pray for me.
Amen.
And so that I too can pray for you.
Amen.
And I'm doing that with my wife Stella. So don't think that we just see only myself. When we talk about the history, it's important for us to know, because we have generation that is following. They need to have a foundation. They need to understand where we are coming from. And when the Lord will have taken us away and things are given to them, they need to know where things have been.
Yeah.
And that will help them to focus where to go.
Yes.
That will help them to know that what they are holding is not just something that is just put together in a caricature way. It's something that God himself has put in place with a sure and solid foundation. So there is something about the month of April that we should cherish, we should look forward to. We know God works every time.
Yes.
But I just decided to look into this month of April in terms of occurrences and things that have been happening, and I'm just encouraged. And it is my prayer that God will do something special for you.
Yes.
If not already, we've organized prayer meeting, we have called for special meeting, We have done so many things, and I want to believe from the bottom of my heart that many people have been blessed. Amen. And I can assure you that God still has more for you. Yes. If we will open our heart to the Lord. Above all, we want God to revive us, Amen. To touch us once again. Amen. We want God to break us.
Amen.
We want God to bend us.
Amen.
We want God to reward our anguish.
Amen.
The groaning of our heart that God, please, send fire
Amen.
To the bone of my spirit
Amen.
And quicken me
Amen.
And return me to that old time fire.
Amen.
The Lord is able
Yes.
to do that. I did mention that God himself planned that we have in place the series of Revival Bible Study. There are six P's. You will see each P. And many people, of course, attended their weekly studies. And many of us did not come, perhaps due to work our situation. And I have decided that maybe we should just wrap up, talk together, bring out some salient points from those six studies that we had prior to Easter. Normally when we do that, for those of you who will remember what we normally do in the past, the following Sunday or thereabout, after we've studied that lesson, we do a review of it together. But because of Easter, we decided to postpone it to this time. For those on the web or on the webcast, we have soft copy of this important study material that we can forward to you. If you will let us know that you are interested by writing to pastor@apostolicfaith.org.uk. pastor@apostolicfaith.org.uk, just to request for this information. We shall be glad to send this to you. And perhaps we may have in all other our congregations as well that are listening to me, it is possible that you may not have these materials and you like to have them. Let us know as well. Arrangement will be made for you to have this material so that you can study this material at home. The review is going to be short and straight to the point. So before I do that, I don't know how God himself revealed to one of our regional overseers in Nigeria, in terms of my own heart desire, that the Lord should revive me and that the Lord should revive his church.
Amen.
Just during the course of this month, one of them, whom we are always in touch, sent something to me that I want to share with you. He sent something to me that I want to share with you on revival. God perhaps revealed to him that there is someone here hungry, thirsty, or what he himself has even observed is going on all around the world in terms of the need for revival. So he sent something to me that I want to read to you. I've made arrangements for this also to be projected, just those points that are self-explanatory. We need revival. At the time when the church has become a ground for entertainment, we need revival. At the time when a music leader competes and compares himself or herself with secular musician, we need revival. At the time when the altar of God is used for comedy, we need revival. At the time when passion for souls have been replaced with fashion parade in the church, we need revival. At the time when motivational speaking has replaced biblical teaching, we need revival. When you really cannot differentiate between a daughter of Zion and an harlot, we need revival. At the time when painting, attachments, jewelry have replaced the beauty of God's glory, we need revival. At the time when sexual sin is referred to as weakness and the grace of God is taken for granted, we need revival. When the church does not know the difference between witchcraft and the Holy Spirit.
Thank you, Lord.
We need revival at a time when sinners feel comfortable in our churches and saints feel no sense of urgency to witness to the lost. We need revival. When the word of God is scarce and the fire on the altar is going out and the priests have become blind, the watchmen sleeping, and holiness is no longer our standard. We need revival. We need revival, not a program. We need reawakening of our souls and a new awareness of the power of God. We do not need another jamboree, but true repentance coupled with a changed life. We do not need another noise. We need a shaking and a mighty rushing wind.
Amen.
We do not need another movement. We need a reformation.
Amen.
We need the Lord to come again and restore us unto himself.
Amen.
We need the Lord to open our eyes again.
Amen.
That we may see him.
Amen.
We want to see his holiness again.
Amen.
That we may see our depravity. We need a genuine outpouring of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
There is no other desire that we have than to hear again the same voice that spoke in the valley of dry bones.
Amen.
To bring us back to life.
Amen.
We cannot pretend anymore. We need to activate the power of Holy Ghost and he will reawaken us.
Amen.
Let us pray that God should have mercy upon us.
Amen.
And revive us again.
Amen.
Let revival hit the earth.
Amen.
In these last days, be prepared for the coming of the Lord. It will be like a dream. Do not be caught unaware. I got that for several weeks now, and I kept it on my phone. It was sent to me as a text from this, my reverend gentleman, one of our regional overseers, and that has stuck with me since then. May God give us revival.
Amen.
May God revive our soul.
Amen.
When I will be concerned with my soul, for my soul,
yes,
getting it right with God, as opposed to my brother or my sister, but my soul,
yeah,
my soul, your soul. May God help us.
Amen.
So we go to the first P. We go to the first P, which is about perceive, is the first P, which we studied for a whole week. The purpose of that is to look at why we need revival, or our need of revival. Some of you will remember that in that lesson, we looked at what started Welsh revival. A young man of 26 years old, I'm now over 60, and I'm just thinking when I was 26, a young man of just about 26 years old called for a meeting in their church, a simple challenge to those who are interested. May you be interested in revival.
Amen.
May your heart be yearning for revival.
Amen.
May you not just be indifferent.
Amen.
We are looking at ourselves now. Don't look at anybody. Then he gave the challenge. Confess any known sin. Simple. Let me be thinking. You too be thinking. Known sin. We have prayed that the Spirit of God will come down today.
Amen.
And let you know yours. Let me know mine.
Yes.
For the past month or so, the pastors and group leaders of this church, we usually pray together virtually every week. And I always send out the prayer request. The request up till now, every week, has been, God, send us revival. And I know the Lord is going to do it.
Amen.
Confess any known sin. Even you don't need to wait until we come to the altar to pray. That which the Spirit of God is telling you, that you know yourself. Confess. Immediately put away any doubtful habit. Is there anything you are doing that I don't know whether it's right or wrong, doubtful habit, whatever it is, the Spirit of God will explain that to you. To restore any broken relationship, we cannot, you know what I said before? We cannot deceive ourselves. We cannot just be giggling and brother, sister, when there's something different in the heart. There will be no revival in the heart of such individuals. Broken relationships, you know it's broken. You know. And I don't think it's talking only of husband and wife here. Of course, that's part of it. But more than that, he called them to do that. And simply, they did that. And what happened? Fire broke out from heaven. May God come and do that for us.
Amen.
So they then quoted for us in Raven Hill's Revival Praying, who are those that will experience revival? They will be obedient people. They will be humble people. They will be praying people. And that we are to make the move first. And it says that if a farmer had broken no ground, has not spread seed, will he be blaming God because he had no harvest? So you have a part to play, I have a part to play. May God help you and I to play our part today.
Amen.
So I pray, as we are waiting and expecting the Holy Ghost to fall upon our soul, may he help us to perceive our need for revival.
Amen.
The second P, prioritize. That deals with urgency. Urgency. To lay aside every other thing and pursue revival. Make revival our priority. And I'm talking here, well, it's good to pray, God revive the church, and God is going to do that. But when we are treating this lesson, those that were around will remember, we are saying that the church is not these walls that we see. The church is you and I. And if I will do my part, you will do your part. Then we are going to have a revival.
Amen.
So we want to focus on ourselves. In the area of prioritize, they used very good, vivid illustration of how we ruin our appetite even for food. They said that you don't first of all eat your cake and dessert. You eat real good meal first, isn't it?
Yes.
And then at the end, you want to have your dessert. If you fill yourself with cake and all those other stuff and the yogurt and the ice cream and all those things before you eat, you have already filled your stomach with something that is not real food. And we are then admonished that some of us are just snacking on things of the world. Snacking. We are snacking on things that has got nothing to do with God. And then we are crying for revival. Revival won't come. Remember, I'm not even talking of sins here. I'm talking of those things that are lawful but not expedient. We leave those things aside first. Let's do that thing that we know the Lord wants us to do. Prioritize. We don't want to ruin our appetite. May God give us spiritual appetite.
Yeah.
The quoted Charles Finney, who had someone who was on fire for the Lord, who was seeking experience. And what did she do? She mingled with some people that are lukewarm. And that fire that was coming inside her was quenched. And now they were asking us in terms of who do you mingle with? And you said you want revival. Are you mingling with those people that we let they have the fire, you have the fire, you are encouraging yourself, or those that will put you down? And then you say you are looking for revival. They asked us one question that stuck to many of us, I want to believe. They said that if you knew you had just 1 week to live, how will you spend it? If all of us here seated, who have understanding, not the children who may not know what I'm saying, you have 1 week to live. I remember some people saying that day, I will not leave, I just stay here. I won't leave the church. Do it now.
Amen. Amen.
Don't wait until that time, because actually they say if you have 1 week, but if it is 1 day? Because we don't know. And then they advise us to look into our lives and look at those things we may need to put aside, even temporarily. Put those things aside temporarily so you can devote yourself to earnestly seeking God. May God help us to do that.
Amen.
The third P, purify. Purify. Asking God to search our hearts and reveal, I underline in my notes, personal hindrances. Personal hindrances. Not the family hindrances. Not the church hindrances. Don't misunderstand me. I'm not saying those things are not there. But here we're talking of personal hindrances. Something that is personal to you. That you want God to purify you from. For those that were around for our Bible study, for the Easter retreat that we had on Good Friday, we focused on holiness in our actions. And the watchword for that Bible study has to do with what would Jesus do? And in this Bible study material of number three, purify, they brought it up. And they were asking, what would Jesus do about what you see? Do you want a revival? Start thinking. What you are looking at. What do you think Jesus would do? What Jesus would do about where you go? Start thinking. What would Jesus do about what you do? What you say? What you think? People that are hungry and thirsty after revival, they ask themselves questions like this, and they respond to the speaking of the Spirit of God, saying that is wrong, that is not right. Don't say that. What would Jesus do? Jesus won't talk like that. Jesus won't go there. The quote says, we have a quote for every series. I'm not reading everything, but the quote for that particular one, I noted it. He said, brethren, it is just so much humbug to be waiting for this revival night after night, month after month. If we ourselves are not right with God, I must ask myself, is my heart pure? Are my hands clean? Number four, prepare. 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 That is after now you have identified personal hindrances. Then the fourth one now is talking about you taking necessary steps to be sure that those hindrances are removed. And the Spirit of God is always ready to help us. They gave an incident of one of our pastors or one of our ministers who preached a sermon during the camp meeting of July 1958 titled Old Parts. This has to do with Brother Frost, who said something, did something, as little as it was, against someone. And he eventually knew that that's not right. It's not the right thing I've done. And he just wanted to, as many of us may like to do, we just want to go and confess, Jesus, I'm sorry, I've said this, against my employer, or against my boss, or against my brother, please forgive me. And I underline it here. And he said that, as much as he tried to do that, I tried to talk God out of it, but he was not in that kind of mood. God was saying, go and meet the person. Do you want a revival? And God is asking you, go and meet the person. And you are saying, I've prayed. It's all finished. No revival will come. He related in that sermon that until he put it off for days, there's something told him he has to go and make it right. And then he said, you said that is fanaticism? Call it what you want. But in those days, the power used to fall just like rain. Because that is what they do. Why can't we do the same today? You see, the people call themselves brothers, so and so, sisters, so and so. They cannot look at each other in the eyes. And they want revival. Because of what you have heard, of what the enemy has shown you concerning someone. Now you start, the person will come from there, you go from there. No problem. Just let him go on his own way. And I go on my own way. We can't deceive God. No. We are deceiving ourselves.
Yes.
If God says you need to make it right, go and eat your humble pie. The Lord will help you to do it.
Amen.
He has helped many. The devil will be telling you, how can I go and say that myself as a pastor? Now I go and meet that young man and say, I did the, God forgive me. Have mercy upon me. No, no, no. God is saying you have to go. Then they ask us a question. How can a difference between us and a brother or sister hinder revival? And what is our responsibility when a difference or hurt feelings exist? Some of us can contribute to things like this. We can talk. We can make any recommendations. But may God make us doers of the word.
Yeah.
Not just contributors. Responsibility. When there is a hurt feeling, the person that has even done something hurting to you may not even know. And here you are dying under she's like this, he's like that. May the Lord revive us.
Amen.
The fifth P, it is called partner. Focusing on the role of unity. I think that was mentioned this morning. Unity. Very, very important. They gave us the Azusa Revival things that happened in terms of how, irrespective of the age, irrespective of the color, irrespective of their educational attainment, they all just gathered together. All they were after is God. All they were after is the Spirit. All they were after is God, deliver me. Fill me. Fill me now. Fill me now. Empty me. And fire fell upon them. They said that Azusa Mission stands for the unity of God's people everywhere. Just because they came together, they united together. And then they ask us, what are actions that destroy unity? And what are the actions that build unity? Some of these, many of us know. And we can see very well. Which one are you exhibiting? And you are crying for revival. Is it the one that promotes unity with your brother and your sister, or the one that will always cause friction? The Lord is able to revive us.
Amen.
If we will think. Then the last one, prevail. Prevail. And then we were given something to look at under give me a burden. Give me a burden. Burden. Of course, many of us are just too straight. Many of us burden. Some people even tell you, over my dead body. Who want burden? Anguish. God did not design it for me. They are talking of burden for your own soul to begin with. We're talking of burden and passion for other soul. We're talking of anguish in terms of who am I, what has happened to me? What is wrong with my life? In terms of what the Lord has done for me. The quote we got from Leonard Ravenhill book again. Those of us who have read that book, we have two books by Leonard Ravenhill on revival. Hear me. Every Bible daily unopened condemns us. Every promise of God unused condemns us. Every lost neighbor condemns us. Every lost heathen condemns us. Every dry eye among us condemns us. Every unclaimed opportunity for God condemns us. Next year is not ours. Tomorrow may be too late. Unless we repent now, unless we return and fire the prayer altars now, unless we fast and weep now, woe unto us at the judgment. May that not be your lot.
Amen.
May that not be my lot.
Amen.
Then they said that, what are the dangers of studying revival but doing nothing with what you have learned? I appreciate that many of us did not take part in this because of other engagement that we had. But now, we have been able to summarize those things. I've said this many times, and there is no need for anybody to think like that, which has to do with a friend who always run away from me, doesn't want me to preach to him, because anytime we meet, he's always preaching, telling him about his sins, you need God, you have to be saved. And then immediately he will see me, we run away. No, because I know once I hear, it's my responsibility to do. But if I don't hear, no problem. I'm afraid you have heard. I'm afraid I've heard too. It's even more for me who has taught it. So we are in it together.
Yes.
And the Lord is able to help us.
Amen.
So today we want to make true preparation. We want to be honest with ourselves. We want to remove all these guys. We want to remove all those that disclosure, that hiding, covering up, with perhaps the way we dress, perhaps the way we even speak. Some people have very nice way of talking, or the way we do things, that there is no way anybody can know who we are, but God knows. We want to forget the opinion of men, forget even now the opinion of any minister or pastor about you. Pastor may think you are super duper Christian, and you know inside yourself, super. Forget the opinion of any friends. It's a matter between God and your bosom.
Yes.
Bring yourself into the courtroom of your own bosom. Be your own judge. Be your own witness. Be your own solicitor. Be your own accused. Be your own accuser.
Yes.
And do your own cross-examination.
Amen.
We want to answer these following questions faithfully.
Amen.
As we go on our knees to pray. Are you what you once were? Are you really what you once were? Forget, for now, you know me before. Yes, Isaac used to be this. Isaac, forget me now. Let me concentrate on myself. Let us concentrate on ourselves. Are you what you once were? Is it now winter in your soul? Where are the rich moments that you have always been spending before the cross? What canker is feeding in the root of the precious plant of grace in your soul? What are those little foxes that spoil the vines of your soul? You did run well. Who has hindered you from running well? What has enfeebled your faith? What has chilled your love for God? What has lured you back to the weak and beggarly elements of the world? You see people doing things that they left. They are not going to do that again. I've turned my back to the world. And after God has given them rest of mind and everything, they now give it different interpretation. And now they said, well, they now got it right. They got it wrong before. What has lured you back to those beggarly things? Is it the world, creature, ambition, or old leaven unpurged? Search it out. Love of self, pride of life, or lust of the flesh? Is it a sinful habit secretly indulged? You want to go and get it out root and branch. Mortify. Rest not until it is discovered. And the steps you want to take, confess. My love has waxed cold. My affections have weakened. My affections have wandered. My mind has yielded to the corrupting influence of the world. My steps have slackened in the path of holy obedience. Let us set out afresh for God and heaven, as though we had never started in the way before. We must be reconverted.
Yes.
Have you been converted before?
Amen.
You want to pray to God that you want to be reconverted. When we prepare like this, by thoroughly examining ourselves, you know what is going to happen? I have that scripture to read to you as we go on our knees to pray. Joel 2:18 says, Joel 2:18 says, then, hallelujah,
Amen.
It's not the end. There is hope.
Yes.
Then will the Lord be jealous for his land and pity his people. The Lord will answer and say unto his people, behold, I will send you corn and wine and oil, and ye shall be satisfied therewith. And I will no more make you a reproach among the heathen. Continue from verse 24, it says, and I will be glad, from verse 23, be glad then, ye children of Zion, and rejoice in the Lord your God, for he hath given you the former rain moderately, and he will cause to come down for you the rain, the former rain, and the latter rain in the first month, and the floors shall be full of wheat, and the fat shall overflow with wine and oil. Verse 25, and I will restore to you the years that the locust has eaten, the cankerworm, and the caterpillar, and the palmerworm, my great army, which I sent among you, and ye shall eat in plenty, and be satisfied, and praise the name of the Lord your God, that has dealt wondrously with you, and my people shall never be ashamed, and ye shall know that I am in the midst of Israel, that I am the Lord your God, and none else, and my people shall never be ashamed. It shall come to pass, I will pour out my spirit upon the servants, upon the handmaids, upon everyone that will gather together to call upon my name. God is ready to pour out his spirit if we will take these steps seriously. Do you feel like you are hungry? Are you thirsty? Do you want God to refill you? Do you want to be reconverted? Is something tugging the soul of your heart that you need revival? Do you want to confess to the Lord? Do you want to cry to God to help you? Do you want to let God know that you are not what you once were? Do you want the Lord to touch you? Touch your people once again. Touch me once again. Save my soul afresh. Sanctify me. Pour out your spirit upon me. I am hungry for God. I know my spirit is testifying against me that I am not what I once was. I want to return to my first love. And I know, oh Lord, you are ready to receive me. You are ready to bless me. You are ready to revive me. The Lord of Azusa Street, the Lord of Evan Roberts, the Lord of the Wesleys, the Lord of Luther, the Lord of our forefathers, can be your own God today and revive your soul. I encourage you to pray until you know your heart is revived. God bless you as you pray.